and the rights against exploitation is to show that he has succumbed. I think the intersectionality is very, very important. The only thing here I'm emphasizing here is this specific aspect of work and dissent. Friends, I think one appeal to you all is we must find a word that if you say, even in India, sorry, I'm a little digressing from this point, each other, and we see, sometimes not we see, the opponents see as a genocide. In Maharashtra, if you go, everybody will put Mahar and Mang communities against each other. These are the things. They'll say, okay, Mahars have cornered all political things. The Mang community has not. So the rulers have an interest in seeing that we don't ban. And then this is where I think one of the greatest feats of Babasaheb Ambedkar is he has managed to bring us unto one thing, whether it is Jammu and Kashmir in the north or Kanyakumari in the south or Asansol, Assam in the east and then Mumbai in the west. He has brought this huge community who did not see eye to eye at one point as one name, scheduled caste. I mean, people, we don't recognize it. We don't have any such thing at the globally together. Because this particular form, and this is my appeal to Magda and Abda and several other leaders whom we don't have, we have not sufficiently mapped. We need to have a unity of this. So this particular thing is, we have to, there is a thing called race. And academically, I think race and these forms are different because Abda and Abda especially will share with you that they're from the same race. Harathim are blacks. Harathim have the same culture. But they are not regarded because they are shunned aside. And they want to keep you aside and still enslave you. This is the worst thing of casteism. You're wrong. And you want to enslave them. And you want to still keep them out. Same religion does not allow the members to come into the temple. What kind of a religion is this? Now, this has to be the clear, how do you say, break from the thing to say that, okay, we are all one culture, brothers and sisters, but you never treated me as your brother. And we need to form together. I think, so this is where I'm trying to make this emphasize. Yes, we need solidarity between race and caste, but presently we also need to focus on this whole discrimination based on work and dissent. But we have to find, I don't like using this DWD thing, but we need to find Surat some better word. I don't know how we are going to find this word because it needs some kind of a social engineering. Elite capturing of resource is there, but I think, see, if you didn't have people like Suraj and Sanjay and Sampar and all of you here who have been, you know, pushing at this, of course they are elite in our community, or even me, why should I exclude myself? I'm also little elite because whoever speaks English and has a passport and has come to US cannot be the same as Rangamma, Ramamma and Ramdas or Haridas in any of the communities. We are, of course. But we have an accountability to the community. That is another dialogue. But then just because Paul speaks in English and he can wear the same coat as John and speaks also of the thing and has had access to Brandeis University does not take my right away from fighting for the rights of our community. And I agree, there are many such mistakes. It's a mistake in the sense that it's an evolving. I think tomorrow we should tear this because I'm sure Magda will tear it and say this is not the way we want to describe Romas in this booklet. And Abda will also tear it away and sorry brother, you have not really sufficiently brought out the depth of the community there in Africa. So this is only something because I don't know, as Dalits, Suraj and others will disagree with me, Jaspreet, I have not sufficiently exercised my academic side of it. I wish I could write better. But I think this is an emerging thing. We have to encourage and then see how we can be brought under one thing so that, you know, whichever part of the world this takes place, we can build a bond and solidarity and fight against the system wherever it takes place.
Thank you, Dr. Paul. What I'd like to suggest, because we were supposed to begin at 10, we're trying to conclude at 2. We have 2 speakers and a plenary and lunch.
No,
please. This is excellent, and I'm glad this is being captured, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yep. What I'd like to suggest is have our 2 questions from the audience. Make your points. Dr. Paul, if you can just make a note, and what we'll do is respond at the end of the plenary. So keep in mind their notes, we're going to get more questions, but I want to at least give some room for the floor. So if you can make that brief, and then I'll make my transition back there. So please.
Yeah, my question is very brief, and that if you can deliberate a little bit upon this atrocities against SCST Act in India, and you know whether it is a possible operational point of communities and groups to work around, or we know it has been a total failure with very low conviction rates, and you know the kind of atrocities against Dalits and Adivasis rising in India, whether there is something to be thought around or not.
Great, thank you. We'll flag that question. Just for you.
Yeah, mine is somewhat similar to what you said. Paul, you talked about this inclusive monitoring mechanisms at the end, in the recommendation sections, you talked about inclusive monitoring mechanisms. I would love to hear more about what your thoughts are on that. And also, I was reading a piece about from Babasaheb, which says that he was one of the anti things between Gandhi and Babasaheb was that Gandhi was in towards the idea of village rule, whereas Babasaheb said that if the village rule exists, which is basically the idea of decentralization of power in India. If that happens, the power will come in the hands of the upper caste elites in the village. And that would affect the Dalit community being able to get their rights. And the whole idea about democracy, being able, like everybody able to vote and get their representation itself, is like is a flaw in the system, because if the majority votes, the minority rights still don't count in the representation in democracy, as I understand. So, like this whole idea about women participation and Dalit participation in politics, how do you navigate that problem is something which has.
So what I'll have is Dr. Paul will open the plenary by addressing these 2 questions. So we'll lead the plenary. But we're going to move to a transition now. Thank you, audience, for the speech.
Okay.
And let's give a round of embodied passion, experience, wisdom in Mr. Paul's work over so many decades. And the only 2 points I'd like to glean from his talk is that in this age of neoliberalism, in this age from a post-colonial critique, the neo-colonial domination that continues, even at the multilateral space, this problem of dissent is the lack of neoliberalism is being marginalized in business. That's a phenomenon in itself. One thing you talked about, the lack of discussion of race within caste in the greater than equality kernel statement, in which a single race can oppress its own, as opposed to the black-white binary that you might have in the United States with white supremacy and the black experience. And let's not forget, it didn't come up, and I think it will in our comparative discussion, that there is a problem of race within caste. Mm. Casteism and racism are analogous. People of African descent, the question of dark-skinned people, the people of Assam that are not Indian and Asiatic. And lastly, as I transition to Mandel, we should recall Marx's own thinking. On the one hand, he praised the birth of capitalism for one moment. Of course, he became its most ardent critic, because he thought it would free African Americans from slavery. Something about the capitalist mode of production changes the social relations of production, invisibilizes human capital, and then sells it on the market. He calls that formal freedom of equality. Of course, within capitalism, people get exploited and alienated, and he begins his critique. But he is a Eurocentric guy at the time, which is the white supremacist, racist baggage of all European thinking. He said the left makes a line between capitalism and intellectualism. He himself had to make a distinction between Western capitalism, which can undergo this massive transformation towards socialism, and the Oriental modes that are stuck in this vegetative state, to quote him, very racist language, in which the movement towards modernity is not going to change the social structure. So descent based on hereditary traits, sociobiological reductionism to work and occupation. He talked about this. We won't see the dismantling of something like the caste system in India just because we move into modernity in general. But Dr. Paul's remarks are spot on. We need to make the critique of race and racism. We need to overcome this question of work and descent in its oriental modes, to quote Marx. And we need to revisit Ambedkar's legacy so we can think about the movement towards not the Western conception of socialism, but something more radical that can actually, as Ambedkar says, destroy the anatomy of the caste system. That's within the Shastras. It's a double critique. You have to destroy the structure of Hinduism, and inside that structure is the anatomy of caste, which to the outside world, the Western world, is totally invisible. That is the depth of the commitment. So with that, I'd like to move to Magda. I'm going to bring up your presentation, and we will begin our second position. We'll close after Magda's discussion and Q&A. We'll have lunch, come back, and we'll close with Abna and Bartholomew. So, can we just
good afternoon, everyone, and thank you so much for your kind words and introduction, Suraj. It is such a great honor to be here today. And it's also quite intimidating, I have to say, given the level of expertise, knowledge, and wisdom of the other panelists. Tomorrow, the UN is going to launch a one-year-long campaign for the 17th anniversary of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. And I think that 2018 is really a good opportunity for us activists, scholars, and advocates to think, to reshape, and somehow to come up with better mechanisms and the solutions to make the human rights mechanisms that are now in place much more effective for all of us. In my presentation today, I'll try to tackle two issues. I will start with a brief introduction about the Roma, and I'll try to underline a few parallels with the Dalit communities. And by doing so, and I think I said that before, I remain mindful about the unique and specific struggles of the Dalit communities. I will then discuss some of the challenges that the Roma movement has had in the past decades in using UN mechanisms and other regional human rights mechanisms in Europe. And I'll focus a little bit on the International Convention on Elimination of Racial Discrimination. So let me start with the Roma. The Roma or the Roma people is an umbrella term that we use for Roma, Gitanos, Sinti, Manush, subgroups that you can meet everywhere in Europe and in other regions. Oftentimes in the European context, much more in the American context, we are pejoratively called gypsies. Roma origins are in India, and I think this is, you know, part of the connection that needs also to be put on the table. And scholars estimate that the migration of the Roma to Europe has happened about 1,000 years ago or so. Today, we have like about 14 to 15 million Roma living across the world. The majority of them live in Europe. There are like about 12 million Roma living in Central, Eastern Europe, and so on. But there is also quite a large population of Roma in Australia, Latin America, United States, and there are some Roma-related groups in the Middle East as well. Roma are citizens of the countries they live in. Unless some of the institutional barriers hinder that citizenship. Throughout the centuries, there was like a persistent powerful to powerless relationship between the non-Roma population and the Roma population. In Europe, for more than seven centuries, Roma have gone through different forms of exclusion and violence. In Romania, they've been slaves for 500 years. About 1.5 million Roma have been killed during the Holocaust. They've experienced forced assimilation in Central and Eastern Europe until the 90s. And they've also experienced forced sterilization of Romani women till recently in the Czech Republic, Slovakia, and there is quite a long history of forced sterilization in Sweden as well. Europeans have never seen us as falling under the umbrella of the European citizen, which you may think that is more an image of a white Christian European. And one of the earlier scholars categorized Roma as a distinct race without religion and perhaps without morals. And also, we have for centuries lived among superior nations. And this idea of gypsy criminality and gypsy inferiority has been embedded in the European culture for centuries. The misrepresentation of the Roma as a dangerous race helped build up a low-ranking gypsy identity. And this is how we are seen today as well. And the more the non-Roma have problematized the Roma and presented them as inferior and dangerous, the more evidently white supremacy and whiteness, and what we call gajeness in our own language, has been has gained power and also value. More so, the history and the collective memory of domination and power imposed through these sort of anti-Romani policies, including the slavery and the killings and the forced assimilation, not only that have not received any recognition in the history of Europe, but have also pushed and maintained very real the anti-Romani sentiments up to today. And finally, Roma have been called Athenganos or Athenganoi, which in the old Greek language means literally untouchable or impure. And up to the present day, the non-Roma continue, in spite of our protests, to call us Zigonski, Zigoiner. All of these terms are variation of the untouchable terminology.
Can you repeat what was the term again?
Athenganos, it's in old Greek. So, in many ways, the basic idea of untouchability is very much familiar to my people and to our community. Also, similar to India, the de jure abolition of discrimination and the ratification of some UN human rights mechanisms have not led to the dismantle of the fact of discrimination, which continues to manifest it really in all aspects of life. In 2016, for instance, in a Pew Research Center survey, 85% of Italians, 66% of French, and 53% of Greeks, they all had unfavorable opinions about the Roma. And it's not just that they have unfavorable opinions. These opinions do translate into policies and do translate into practices as well. For instance, Rural Many children are oftentimes segregated in special schools for children with mental disabilities. They are also placed in separated school buildings and in separated classes. And the only argument for that is really their ethnicity. Oftentimes, I think you hear that the Roma or the Gypsies do not value education. And this is something that many Europeans would first say to you when you ask what they think about the Roma. Where in fact, in many countries, children do enroll to school. In Hungary, more than 95% of Romani children enroll to the first grade. What happens is that they get segregated. And it's not just segregation and the act of discrimination, but it's also the fact that the quality of education in these classrooms is very, very poor. They don't get to learn how to read and to write by the end of primary school. And those who actually practice absenteeism are not the kids. These are the teachers. Mm. And there is studies showing that that's a phenomenon happening in Roma-only schools and classes. They are also often placed in the back of the classroom, and this happens to other minorities as well. And violence against children, from physical violence to bullying, also occur inside and outside the school environment. We had an incident a few months ago, and I think that spoke to many other incidents in the Dalit communities where a young boy was beaten by a young Roma boy in Bulgaria was beaten up by a Bulgarian because he was asked if he thought that Roma were equal with Bulgarians, and the boy dared to say yes. And that violent incident went to a level that was hard to imagine. Also, entire Roma communities in different European countries are just pushed at the margins. So residential segregation is really a big issue, and is not a choice of the communities. It's just that they are pushed away from the communities. And you may believe it or not, but in Europe, there are walls that separate the Roma communities from the non-Roma communities. In Romania, in Slovakia, mayors have built walls just to make sure that the non-Roma do not get to meet with the Roma. And we organize protests against these practices, and we try to challenge in the court, but the walls are still there. Also, speaking of new trends of fascism and neoliberalism and so on, in Europe, I think we really need to look more carefully at how minorities are treated, because in the past decade, a lot of violent attacks, extremist attacks, hate crime, and hate speech have in many ways become the norm in Roma communities. In some countries, extremist groups and paramilitary groups organize military trainings for their members. And in other countries, these groups also get to kill Roma and Roma children and their families. And Hungary has been one of the countries where you would see these incidents happening very often. But I want to stop here because I think, you know, I could go on and on talking about violence against Roma and discrimination. And I think the purpose of this presentation is not necessarily to look at all these types of human rights violations, but rather to see where we connect. And here's where I want to make two parallels. One is really to say that the goal of separation and pushing Dalit families away at the margins has been a tactic used against Roma communities as well for many years. And the use of violence to punish and to control the Dalit communities is also practiced against the Roma communities as well. A few months ago, we had another panel here talking about the similarities between Roma and the Dalits, and I talked more in depth about the similarities, and I don't want to repeat that. But I do hope that you get to read the piece that Suraj and I wrote about these similarities and think a little bit further about that. So the second point is really to build on Paul's recommendations at the end of his presentation. And to think a little bit at the implementation of the UN mechanisms that we actually have in place, and to think how we can improve them. And I'll just give you this example. So while I kind of recognize the importance of the International Convention on the Elimination of Racial Discrimination as a monitoring treaty body, I also acknowledge that it has limited capacity. And we can learn from that limited capacity in thinking over about what we want to do at the level of UN and how would the next mechanisms look like, right? So for instance, if you look at the Convention on the Elimination of Racial Discrimination and the committee itself, their urgent action, early warning procedure, and also the individual petition mechanism lack awareness in local communities, and also implementation. Not many of the people in our communities really know about these mechanisms, and neither the local NGOs. Also, during the official sessions, observers, including NGOs, do have the right to be in the room, but they don't have the right to speak. And I think that's an issue that we need to challenge, and we need to change in the next few years. Also, as the committee uses these shadow reports from the NGOs, very often it's a big struggle for the NGOs themselves to come up with their reports and to go and present the results of these reports in front of the UN. So that's also something that I think it needs to be discussed. And we need to come up with recommendations in order to really make these mechanisms work much better. So I do hope that during the discussion today, we debate and we deconstruct the patterns of oppression at global level, and we discuss much more the effectiveness of the UN mechanisms, and come up with ideas on moving forward for the Roma, the Dalits, and other groups that are in similar situations with our communities. And I think that the tactics of and the strategies of oppression synchronizes across continents and across countries. And they take the forms of violence and mass incarceration and structural discrimination, segregation, lack of access to education, and lack of access to health. But then how could the oppressed move forward without changing the minds and behavior of the oppressed? Is this a matter of integration and inclusion, or this is more a matter of emancipating the dominant population, starting from the schools and the citizens and continuing with the state institutions? And I think that part of the more theoretical challenge of the Convention on the Elimination of all of Racial Discrimination, but also of other UN mechanisms, is how to shift the focus from the minority as a problem to the majority as the target. Mm. And finally, just to build on more on your points, Paul, I think it's also relevant for us to think how we imagine these UN mechanisms, but not only, also some other regional mechanisms, in a way that we create solidarity because I think that it's not an innocent decision for many to just keep us separated and let us work in isolation. So I think this is really a hope that I have for the next year, that we work together and we try to create more solidarity between our groups. And I'll stop here because it's always a challenge to talk about Roma issues in an American audience. I never know exactly who knows what, and I just don't like to repeat myself. But I'm open to any kind of questions. And yeah, please feel free to ask sensitive questions. I will try them.
So well, thank you, Magda. Let's open the floor. We're waiting on the food, so if we have just a few questions, we might be able to move to Abdul's talk, finish all the speakers and discussion, get the food, come back and do the plenary with everybody. So why don't we just see if we have a couple of questions first.
Yes, please, John. Thank you so much. And this may be something you presented in your other one. On the question of work, labor in Romania being upward of 90% Roma. Could you sort of just paint a bit of a picture of the kind of occupational side of the Roma situation in Europe?
So let me put it this way. Only 1% Roma in Europe make it to college. About 10% of them somehow succeed to get to high school. And there are a lot of structural problems why this happens. Segregation is really one of the factors. Discrimination is also a factor that pushes them out of school in many ways and creates a lot of traumas because of your work. So that creates somehow disadvantage when it comes to workforce anyhow, because I think that in a European Union, for instance, that advances much more towards tech skills and educated people with college and so on, Roma are not competitive on the market, on the market where they would want to be. And on top of that, regardless of your education, if an employer knows that you are Roma, you don't get a chance to get a job. And I experienced that. I know some of the most educated Roma in Romania have tried to get jobs, and it's complicated. Unless they work in an NGO, they don't get a good job. So that's also part of the picture. We've been slaves for 500 years in Romania, and that really contributed also a lot to the way that the Gage, the non-Roma, see us, but also in the way that ourselves perceive what we can do. So many of our people work for the Gage, for the non-Roma, and that's the normal. They would, you know, work on their lands. This is what we've done in the slavery period as well. They would clean their houses. They would do the dirty jobs. If you go to a mall in Bucharest, you'll see that those who clean everything are Roma. If you go to any place where there is a low-paid job, those are the of the Roma. And even those jobs are hard to get because the gypsy community is still there and people are afraid that we are going to steal something. So to make it simple, job and labor market is really a problem for the Roma, given that, you know, in the past we had our own crafts that are not anymore on the market now, and also given the level of discrimination and the lack of education that and all that puzzle make it very difficult for the Roma to get good jobs.
Yes,
Ima.
Thanks so much. So I really appreciated what you were saying about how to really shift the focus from the minority, you know, apologize, there's this problem, to the majority, and started thinking about that. And I guess, you know, I'm just I find that anytime that I bring that work up or talk to anyone in American context about that, it's just so heavily saturated with this mythology and romanticism, these ideas, right, about Roma. And I often feel like I'm at a loss to kind of expand the conversation to actually like the real human rights issues that are occurring. But, you know, it's kind of like this cultural idea that we feel like people feel like they know like what the issues are for Roma. And so I'm wondering, just in terms of activism, like, what's your strategy for, you know, speaking to, I don't know, for, you know, speaking to people? Do you feel that even that's an important avenue, you know, to help normal, you know, like, I don't know, average people that maybe don't know anything about these issues? Is that even important? Or, like, kind of what's your strategy for overcoming, like, that romanticism?
So there is a whole Roma movement in Europe working on that topic, and they are trying to dismantle the anti-Romani sentiments and also these ideas of the exotic Roma, the other Roma, and so on. But in the U.S., it's less work conducted on that because there are only a few activists and scholars working on this topic. And therefore, we all try to put a lot of effort into going to events, responding to all media requests, writing as much as we can in order to raise awareness. It's not easy for us to keep up with everything because once in a while you'll see a TV show on an American station about the gypsy criminality or the gypsy sisters or gypsies here and gypsies there. And the reactions are there, right? We try to write petitions, to criticize, but is when you criticize and bring a, you know, a race question in relation to Roma is not the same as you would have raised the same question for any other group, because we don't have the social power. We don't have the power to say, well, this is wrong and this is racism. You know, everyone finds it a little bit acceptable to think about the Roma as criminals and so on. You know, I found also a lot of interesting people who wanted to learn about all these, you know, derogatory words and also negative perceptions. When I tell people that to be gypped in English comes from the gypsy criminality, they apologize, and they feel bad. And that's just because there is not awareness. At Harvard, what I'm trying to do, and I've done that for 5 years, is really to involve the student body into discussions on Roma. And I go to events, they talk about food, I talk about Roma, I find a way to ask the question that is brought every time I'm in the room. So I raise awareness, because many of the students, at least at the Kennedy School, are not just students at the Kennedy School. They are also future policy makers. Mm-hmm. Many of them in Europe, and I do want them to understand that there is bias.
Mm-hmm.
It's a long process, but I think that all of us are trying to bring a small contribution, and I think that your contribution and also others at Brandeis and any other universities in the U.S. can really, you know, make a change, because we need to raise awareness about this topic. Mm-hmm. And I'm really grateful for your awareness.
Can we take one more question? I'll do some completely interrupting as we transition to admin. So just one brief question.
Thank you,
Chris.
I'm just curious to know how different policy regimes and policy systems have addressed this question, and what have been their shifting rationalities and ethical protocols. So there must be some sort of shifts across the time span. So I'm just curious about that.
You know, most of the Roma population are gathered in Central and Eastern Europe. And that part of Europe has also been, for quite a while, under a communist regime, or under communist regimes. And that shifted a lot, I think, the Roma identity in many ways. It shaped it in all the possible ways, because on one hand, discrimination was forbidden in these countries. Mm. You're not allowed to call anyone a Roma or Hungarian if they were, you know, minority in the country and so on. But on the other hand, we've been stripped of our language, culture, and crust. Mm. So, for instance, I don't speak Romani, and I always feel that that's a loss for my own personal identity. I feel that my Roma identity is much more political than actual. So, you know, there is a loss there that I think that many of us miss. And the shift from communism to democracy in Central and Eastern Europe was not easy. We were amazed when Havel came and said that, you know, the test for our democracies is really the treatment of the Roma. And we thought that that will change dramatically the situation of the Roma. It has not so far, because the end of the communism really brought a lot of frustration out. In Romania, at the beginning of the 90s, we had more than 40 what Romanians call inter-ethnic conflicts, but they were more pogroms, because the Roma were not violent, were just the non-Roma putting their houses on fire and expelling them from the communities and killing them. And that's how the frustration came up. But, you know, there is a positive note, that because the transition to democracy also made a change from having, in the beginning of 90s, no Roma awareness in policies and laws and also in the level of implementation, to now, when 27 years later, in every European country and even at the level of the European Union, you have policies that are designed for the Roma, and they mention the Roma, and the laws are a little bit more sensitive about the Roma. Does it really work in reality? It doesn't, because the communities continue to be as poor as they were in the 90s. And I think the change can be seen mostly in activism and at the elites level, but not so much in our communities. And there are different political regimes, like Eastern Europe, in most countries, they recognize the rights of the minorities. There is a lot of work on cultural rights, language, and so on. Whereas in France, for instance, where, you know, Roma along with many other minorities are not recognized because this is how the constitution of France works, that's a very different environment too, because on one hand there is no recognition of this minority and everyone is equal and French, but on the other hand, if you look at the policies that the government, regardless of who is in charge in the government of France, if you look at their policies, they do target the Roma. They issued a proposal, a law proposal, I think that back in 2008, I think, where they wanted to fingerprint those who were traveling inside and outside of France. And that was because the Roma were very visible in France. So, you know, on one hand, there is an idea of everyone is equal, but on the other hand, they do target minorities when they want to. And overall, I think I'm, you know, I have a background in activism. I'm more careful when I write, but when I speak, I do say these things very clearly. It doesn't work. The reason why it doesn't work with the Roma in Europe is racism. There is nothing else. It's discrimination against them, and is the biases that the policy makers do have against them.
So, thank you, Manda, for this point.
Manda's courage and conviction. And the concluding reflection here as we transition to our next speaker is, you know, I really applaud the work that Manda is doing at Mr. Raj. I'd love to see this be shared with the community. And this is my question for you as we think about the planet and the entire group. If you take the Black experience, and then you take the caste experience, and you take those two lenses to shine it on the uniqueness of the Roma oppression, why do the categories here in these two dimensions collapse when we're trying to capture this complexity, not just because of the lack of social power? So let's just try to lay out some of the dialectical contradictions.
Huh.
In the black experience, there's an expropriation from a different geography, the continent of Africa, ensconced into a system of slavery 500 years ago, which then leads to modalities of oppression that change over time. Segregation through the civil rights, and now it's built into our state system. State violence against blacks, the school to prison pipeline, deterioration of the public sector in the inner cities. But the black and white, white and then black and other racial identities, that's a dialectical structure that we don't find in caste per se, although as I mentioned in my earlier comment, we do. But why does the MoMA picture complicate even that structure? Because the inverse is that there is the assertion of black power. There is the assertion of the visibility of the social movement, like Black Lives Matter today, civil rights in the past. There is the rise of people to power in certain positions. There's a collectivity that goes back to the boys in terms of associations with the NAACP. For the caste system, there's an indigenous structure whose origins are unknown, born from one religion, not any other religion. It continues in a certain geographic context and spreads through the global diaspora. There's caste discrimination. But here you have, irrespective of the question of color and the assertion of power, also an attempt to assert identity, also an attempt to capture through reservations in both employment, only the public sector, by the policy, and schools. And there's the possibility with the legacy of Ambedkar to take on socialism, Buddhism, and perhaps a new model of the socioeconomy that would completely dismantle the democratic structure that India inherited because of Gandhi. Not because of the architecture of the Ambedkar, but because of the democracy that was formed that continues to oppress other peoples. African Americans speak about the utter disaster of democracy today. Dalits and untouchable and caste, middle caste speak of the democratic system of India continuing to act with impunity on the greatest atrocities. But why do these both these systems fail in their limitations to understand MoMA? MoMA is a displacement. MoMA is the invisibilization within the most white supremacist, if you will, context based on the figures you showed us. The historical conflation you had to suffer under the oppression of other peoples within the European context in the 20th century, through the Holocaust. Your suffering took place through the targeted oppression of another group. And then lastly, the lack of social assertion and power, not just because maybe the size of the population dispersed over 700 million people, even you, but really, you take almost the worst dimensions of black oppression and dog oppression and telescope it into the structure of the European context, which the world is. It's almost like a living continuity of all those other systems within those other two groups. And in conclusion, one last point. Foucault speaks about governmentality. That means when the state, under the name of law, justice, policy, organization, order, protection against external enemies, just war, constantly has to experiment on a group of people, has to invent ways to perfect the minutia of the way violence takes place against a people who's primordially designated as others. They're completely marginalized. The people without morals, the people without citizenship, the people without religion, the people without identity. A Foucaultian analysis would say, this is exactly the kind of group that states continue to experiment with.
Yeah.
And because it becomes so tranquil, the global scale can't recognize it, national economies can't recognize it, it almost capsizes the possibility to create an indigenous or minority assertion of self-power, which you do have with black power and Dalit movements. So here's a group that also suffers under the experimentation of the state to pathologize, criminalize, and silence. So I want to leave us with that. I mean, we're now moving into three different areas of the comparison of oppression. Black, Dalit, and now the woman. So with that, we're going to move to our final speaker.
Mm-hmm.
We'll go for a good 30 minutes. The presentation is about 20 to 30 minutes. 20 minutes or so. We'll do 10 to 15 minutes of Q&A. We'll break, get the food, and then finish with our plenary adult speakers.
Mm-hmm.
So please welcome. I want to introduce, Abdurrahman is what I'd rather say in the in true extent of his name, but he says, please call him as Abda, and I will bring up his slide.
I was saying to myself, it's going to be very hard to speak after my little sister Magda and my mentor Paul. My brother Suraj made it very difficult when he presented our brother Sampas as the follower of Jacques Derrida. For us to work for Podestria. But it's, I mean, the philosophical background of our ideas based on the deconstructions. And so we have to read Jacques Derrida, and knowing he has one of his students here makes things a lot even more difficult. However, I will try to just to talk a little bit about slavery and racism in Africa in general. I will focus on Mauritania to explain more and tell you what have been done so far. And the title of my presentation is very simple. It's Dalits and Harakins are human. I could also have say Dalits, Harakins, and Roma. Human beings. Why? Because there are eventually in the university level, you all agree they are all human beings. But in the reality, that is not the case. Mostly if you are coming from countries such as Mauritania, and not only Mauritania, but when you are coming from Africa. And I will move to the context. Today, the context is a little bit crucial because of what happened in Libya. Since 2015, hundreds of thousands of refugees and migrants have crossed the Mediterranean into Europe from Africa and the Middle East. Known as the gateway of Europe, Libya has seen many people pass through its border as part of their journey. Unfortunately, traffickers are exploiting the complete lack of governance in the country of immigrant and refugee desperation. Slave markets are flourishing around Libya. And when I say slave market, it's true, it's like an auction. And my brothers and sisters who are coming from basically the Western countries of Africa are stuck in Libya and are being auctioned and sold. And of course, the selling of slaves go often with human rights violations. And the images that you see are real. We get to see it, and we were in that part of the world to see how our brothers and sisters who just wanted to go to Europe to find a better life, ended up being in Libya and being sold as slaves, as it used to happen in the past. Mm. So for us, the past is the present, and the present is the past. Mm. Well, this is not fake images, these images are realities of my brothers and sisters who were basically just trying to make a better life. On their way to Europe, they ended up basically in Libya. And as you can see, Libya is becoming a place where human beings are suffering. Now, for us, this is not news. This is our everyday life. And there are communities in Africa who've been experiencing this kind of situation for centuries. It happened in the country of my birth, I mean Mauritania. Mauritania is, of course, located in West Africa, west north, and it's in between the northern part of Africa and the western part of Africa. And it's a meeting point where you have two groups of people. You have Arabs who live in the northern part and Africans who live in the southern part of Africa. And the interaction of these two people have created a huge population of what is called Haratin or slave. Haratin are so referred to us as Haratin in the front of our half-time, or this dweller in the Sahara, especially in the Maghreb. They are particularly found in Mauritania, Morocco, and of course in the Western Sahara. Today, in 2017, almost in 2018, there are people, like I used to say, who belong to other people. And it happened in Mauritania. And the world knows about it, but nobody cares. So we have our Dalit people. The thing is, slavery was outlawed or abolished four times. Why four times? Why even two times? If it's if the abolition is effective, we shouldn't have like another type of abolition. That means culturally, people are not willing really to leave the Haftali area, to let them go and to free them. And as Paul said in his presentation, Haftali are blacks. So the domination is not on just the base of their color, because we have other groups who are Fulani, who are Sunni, who are Bamba, who are not treated as slaves because they didn't inherited like was the Haratin. So you have a huge group, almost 34 to 40% of Mauritanians who are descendants of slaves and who are belong to other people as we are speaking. Mauritania is not just dealing with slavery, we are dealing with racism. So Africans who are Fulani, Wolof, Soninke, and Bambara, who live in the southern part of Mauritania, are also treated as a second-class citizen in their own country. To illustrate what I'm saying, I will give you just three examples. The first one was in 1986, a group of intellectuals, activists, because to us it's very clear. An intellectual is someone who really wants to change the future of his fellow citizen. Otherwise, we are just a scholar, an intellectual. So you have racism and who are done. Racism is done against Fulani, Soninke, Wolof, and even Bambara who live in the southern part of the country. So in 1986, a group of Mauritanians who belong to the African Liberation Forces trying to say, this is not right, it's good for us to come together as a country and see what should be done so we can build a more democratic country. And the response of the government was, wow, blacks are trying now to be awake and to claim for their right in this country, so let's finish them, let's kill them. So they decide just to arrest more than 84 intellectuals, put them in jail, and by some of them died in there. And actually, their manifesto was just a call for a discussion. Mm-hmm. And then a call for a discussion lead to 4 to 5 years in jail. Mm-hmm. That can tell you the kind of regime that we have in the world. That's what happened in 1986. In 1987, the same thing happened with the military. And in 1989, they decided to deport, just to expand, 200,000 blacks. So they can, the idea behind the deportation of blacks was, if you look at Mauritania, the only fertile land is located in the south. The north is deserted. You cannot practice agriculture over there. So to have fewer blacks and to keep exploiting the fertile land, they decide to deport blacks who are leaving from the south to Senegal and to Mauritania. More than 200,000 were deported. I was one of them. I was 16 in 1989 when my family was deported almost 200,000 to Senegal. And the reason of the deportation was just to forget about Mauritania, to go and live in Senegal and in Mali, and not to talk about the issue. So luckily enough, that may answer the question of my little sister, Magda. We had the first generation of freedom fighters met, and they said, this struggle is not a struggle of a generation. So let's prepare the future, let's prepare the youth, so they will take over and continue the struggle. That's what happened, and we are trying to continue the struggle. And I'm pleased to introduce one of my fellow Mauritanians who I met here today, Haridou, who I know through Facebook, and we just met, and he's one of those who want to continue the struggle in, because we cannot be such battle if we don't send our kids to university. And then once they are in the university, they should also go back to the villages and know they belong to the concept of aid is a concept that will alienate Africans. So just go away, let us move away from that concept and know we belong to the people and we don't belong to the elite. The concept of elite was created just to put us aside from our people. And I'm glad we are starting working on this. So what is the response to slavery in Africa? We know we live in a village, in a global village, and we know what happened to Mauritanians shouldn't be left to Mauritanians alone. And we know in this world there are people like black Mauritanians or like, let's say, slave in Nigeria and Niger, who people like this can be found in Asia, in Europe. So we decide to go and discuss with them and know when they were suffering, what did they do to, or what are they doing to put an end to their suffering. And that's how we met with great people like Paul. Paul was being a friend of Mauritanians since basically 2000, and they worked preparing the conference that took place in Durban. So Africans are no longer alone. Dalits in India, Nepal, Bangladesh, Pakistan, and Sri Lanka are experiencing the same situation. And we are pleased to know our brothers and sisters, Roma, are coming together to build an alliance and to work together. And we, at the same time, this is not something that we are just leaving to Paul or to Magda, but this is everybody's struggle. Not only people who are coming from those communities, because at the end of the day, someone can be outside this community and be aware of this is unjust, this is not right, and something needs to be done. And this person or those people are welcome to the fight. So since July, we've been working to bring, to have a common agenda so we can work together. And we met during that high level political conference and decided to do something. And since then, I've been working with some Pan-African organization, Human Rights Coalition, to do things together. And today, it's very easy because of the context of Libya. Everybody is coming together, and we think something has to be done, and we need to let the world know this is not something that should happen, and this struggle will not be pushed to the incoming generation. We have to fight it, and we shouldn't just dump it to the coming generation. We have to do something. And the milestone is everybody in Africa is basically ready. I had a couple of discussions with my fellow human rights activists, and we are ready. We are already organizing rallies in some African capitals, such as Dakar and Cote d'Ivoire. And now many organizations are involved in that matter. So Africa, I would say Africa or some part of some African organizations are ready for the global movement. And I don't know if you are ready, but we are. I'm sure you are. We will go for that global movement so we can bring the issue to the UN. I know the issue is already before the UN, but they need to know this is no longer a Dalit business, but this is everybody's business. And for us, it's not just condemning, but it's also making sure the UN should sanction countries that are still violating these basic human rights. This is, I said conclusions, but this is basically one conclusion. Descent-based discriminated communities should come together to let the world know we are all human beings. And it's a human rights issue. It's no longer just us as communities who are discriminated against, but it's everybody's business. Since I came here, the government has made me feel very good and feel valid. So thanks to Boston Study Group for organizing this event. And thanks to the Asia Debit Rights Forum and Paul B. is here. And thanks to Sanjay, who for the bed and the testing. And thank you, Professor, for everything. And thanks to my younger brother who made the presentation and who is now well known in some Francophone African countries because of a small video that we made and that is basically talking about how Dalits and Africans should come together to work together. So thank you, everybody.
So now, before we prepare for the food, maybe a couple of questions for the audience.
Thank you very much for your presentation. I'm interested to know a little bit about the slavery and how does that exist and what are the ways that you are just applying to reduce that sort of the slavery. And actually, the same question I'd like to the Roma community later on, we'll discuss the subject in a plainly.
That's a very, very difficult question, but slavery is not just existing in Mauritania. Like, it's happened to be listed 14 countries, even though our study will focus on seven countries.
And Mauritania, Sudan is basically getting out of those countries, but slavery exists, like the way that it used to exist in this country. So you have people who were captured during some razzias organized by Arabs. And once they are enslaved, they have to speak the language of their master. So when you go back to Mauritania, for instance, slaves speak Arabic, the language of people who are slaves to them. And it happens that population grow up very fast, quickly, and ended up becoming the most important population, a group of population in Mauritania, for instance. Now, why people don't know about it is basically, that's what I usually say, is when indigenous people are exploiting or discriminating all the indigenous people, it seems like the West doesn't care. That's my opinion. Because it's indigenous, so it's not done in their name. For them to do something, in South Africa, they did something to stop it because it was done in the name of Westerners. And so to stop it, they did something. Now, in countries such as Zaire, when people are killing each other, or in countries such as Rwanda, they don't do anything because it's just indigenous killing all the indigenous. That's one of the reasons why the issue was not as known as it should. The second reason is France has done a lot, not only, to minimize the effect. We live in, we are in America today. I belong to the first generation of Mauritanians who came to the US, who learned how to speak English, and try to just to bring the issue before the Americans. So you have the language barrier, and you have the fact that France never wanted really this kind of issues to be known. And that's the second reason. The third reason is basically what is lacking, or what was lacking in this kind of organization, is everybody is trying to do something internally. The Dalit in India were trying just to fight for themselves without working with the Dalits in Sri Lanka, for instance. Mm-hmm. Now we know we have all to come together. It brings the issue easier to address worldwide and internationally. So I think that was what was lacking. And also the other reason is basically Mauritania used to be a country that is poor. Then you don't have oil, you don't have gold, you don't have mine. No one cares what is the situation. They only care when they have like financial or interest. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Yes, Arjun, the college morning.
Thank you. I'm really happy that I got to be here by coincidence. So, IRA or IRA. They have been doing a great work, like in kind of globalizing and raising awareness about the issue of slavery in Mauritania. But people have like been criticizing them in a way that, for example, just like most of the movement, like it just focuses on like leaders and gaining fame and everything. But what they have been doing has not been really concretely changing of the lives of the people who are allegedly like slaves or have been descendants of the slaves. You as someone like who's been in Qatar working with IRA, do you think have you discussed with them strategies on how to make a touch on changing the lives of the people who are considered slaves in Mauritania? Especially, of course, I have raised the discussion with someone from the movement before, and he said, since the movement is considered like not legal in the country, so the country would not allow them to have any like projects like to improve the lives of the slaves. So do you have anything?
Yes, I do, because I was the one who brought IRA. It's called, it's an organization, and abolish anti-slavery movement. And I brought IRA, FLAM, and the coalition of refugees who live in Senegal together so they can work together. The reason, I mean, the problem that we are having in many African organizations is let's work for to have better institutions. Let's work for principles and forget our personalities, forget our individuals and our political agenda. So I think IRA and other organizations have understood if they don't do it, people will leave them and then continue, will leave them behind and go for their agenda. So the agenda today is to work how to bring, to have a strong movement and not to have strong leaders. Leaders are good, but the most important thing is to have movements, to have institutions. So if I'm no longer here, if I'm tired, someone will, can come and just continue the struggle. So that's why we need, that's the problem of Africa. We need to have what we call in French relief, like successions. And it should be not only in the university, I mean, when it comes to academic, how to form a new generation of African scholar who will be able to, I would say, to write papers that are well written and that are well presented worldwide when it comes to academic. When it comes to music, why we just have people like Youssou N'Dour and Alpha Blondy? Why don't we prepare the new generation of musicians? So the idea, I mean, the African intellectuals have, now I'm talking to Suraj, that's your mission, is to let people know we need to work to have a situation in all kind, in every kind of business that we are doing. Politically, we need to do that. So if we are not here, people like you can come and lead the struggle. I'm not sure if I understand.
Perfect. Thank you for the presentation. As we were setting up, I want to pose a question to Abda and the group about this paradox that we have to think about. We heard about the caste in Dublin situation in India and the diaspora. We've heard of Roma in the European context and globally. I've talked about the black experience here in America. And now from Abner, we're looking at the question of slavery inside the African context. The paradox is that Western democratic institutions and the consensus through neoliberalism and global capitalism and global finance through the multilateral institutions, for anyone who's not black or Roma or Dalit or an African slave within the African context, in the post-colonial context, not the colonial expropriation, is that slavery is temporalized as past. The consensus and the moral consensus is on human trafficking, which is an evil that has to be addressed. The global indigenous movement, which is fighting for the land rights and the right to rename. But that's a very narrow definition, quite frankly, when we think about the other groups. It's not to diminish the suffering of the indigenous or those that suffer under human trafficking across all categories. If the definition in the past, from the colonial encounter to the building of slavery in the transatlantic in Latin America, Brazil, and the United States, if the structure of slavery is the total control of a body to the point where there's no will, and as Hegel says, there's depreciating control of even the ability to understand the next moment in which you live, because you're under a total system of control. The level of alienation that comes through there gets externalized, and the slave starts to see themselves as oppressed. But they lack total physical emancipation. And you can say, well, that lived under the system of slavery. That doesn't exist in the Roma population today, or the Dalit struggles in India and elsewhere. Or this question of African slavery in Africa, in the post-colonial, after decolonization, how can it be? Or that black bodies in this country are killed, punished, and are experiencing a slow genocide within the inner cities through poverty. So we need to adjust the moral calculus. We keep saying slavery is in the back because they have a conception, physical, visual conception of what it is. But we have a new modality of slavery that occurs to certain groups when it becomes insidious. So my challenge to the group is, in order to have the consensus that I'm just talking about, a new type of thinking, or Paul's notion of a new word beyond indigenous, we need a 21st century definition of enslavement when it means that states and majorities continue to collude in the genocide of minorities through invisible means. That's one definition. And my only hypothesis as we close is think about this. I will bring it back to race across all four groups. Whiteness was the majority of the world population from 1500 to 1900 in terms of a global system of power. People of Western European descent, and then Eastern European, and then global. The tipping point can come as early as 2050. The rise of the South, the rise of diversity and demographic groups in the United States, the tipping point can come for the first time in the human imagination, that whiteness is an invisibility by which you then bring into the world all objects of color, those of us that are people of color, many people in this room. We become the external object that's created by the white imagination because we've always been a minority. But what happens when the whiteness becomes a minority in the global structure and whiteness for the first time has to become an object of color? And it's not a question of trying to enslave all white people. We're not trying to invert the order of power, as Paulo Freire says. That's not going to help you. As a Vedic argument, too. Mm-hmm. Not enough to mention the Hindustan and include Dalits, but maintain the structure of Hinduism. You need a radical social transformation, I'd say, of the nature of human beings and society. But one big step is inverting the structure of power, where those that have always been able to categorize and create systems of complicity to harm anything that's not itself, the dehumanization that has to take place through slavery. When another group that's been in power starts to experience its own minority status, a new consciousness can hopefully arise in which enough sympathy and empathy can come in to thwart the apathy that the world is not taking care of your problem. The world is not taking care of Roma. And as Paul says, no one is taking care of at the UN level and through the true depths of suffering of the Dalit people that exist today, because we live under this disguise of democracy. So the challenge for the group as we conclude and move to the food and come back is imagine the possibility of a complete reorientation in power when the group in power now has to become a minority in the eyes of the world. And therefore, what kind of balance and equity and justice are we going to be able to create new principles that we can create, to create new forms of respect, so these kinds of atrocities become unthinkable? So I'll leave you with that. Statement to drop on the ground.
Yeah, sure.
Yes, please
help yourself.
Unfortunately, forgot to bring the plate, so I think we have to use the napkins.
Yes, but we can bring it here and then.